Now let's take a look at how we can construct a neural network and how we can train the neural network to solve a specific vision problem. So here is a basic architecture of a neural network. We've replaced our perceptron here with the sigmoid neuron, and we have an input layer, which essentially are all the inputs, and then we have hidden layers after that, each layer with a set of neurons. We can have any number of hidden layers. We're showing two hidden layers in this case, layer 2 and layer 3, but you can have a large number of hidden layers, and the more you have, the deeper the network gets. So these are your hidden layers. And finally, in this particular case, you have a single neuron in the output layer, which gives you your final output. It doesn't have to be a single neuron. It can be a set of neurons which gives you multiple outputs, depending on what the task demands. Also, I should mention that in our illustration right here, we have a fully connected network where each neuron receives as input the outputs of all the neurons in the previous layer. Doesn't have to be the case. It could receive inputs from a subset of neurons as well. So now let's construct a neural network to solve a specific problem, and that problem is recognizing characters. In particular, recognizing handwritten digits. So here are your handwritten digits, and this is from what's called the MNIST database. It's a database that's widely used for testing the performance of networks. And in this particular case, what's been done is that each one of these handwritten digits has been binarized, thresholded in some way, and then rescaled into an image that is roughly 20 by 20 pixels. And that's sort of your bounding box within which the image is made to sit. And then that image is centered in a larger image, which is about 28 by 28 pixels in size. And that's what you're looking at here. And you can see how challenging this problem is. You look at the digit 3, you see that this one looks quite a bit different from this. You look at this 5, that's dramatically different from this 5, and so on. But we want to develop a recognition system that gives us very high accuracy in terms of recognizing these digits. So what we want to do is to develop this neural network where it takes as input one of these images, these segmented images of size 28 by 28. You'll call it the normalized input because you might do some simple brightness normalizations in order to make sure that it is more or less a binary image except for the edges of the digit itself. But this could be any number of pre-processing steps that one applies to make the data more amenable to recognition. And then as output here, you have 10 outputs, and each one of these corresponds to a specific digit. So the idea here is to develop a network that gives you a high activation or output for the digit that it thinks the input corresponds to, and a low output for all the other digits. So in this particular case, you would want this one to be high and the rest to be low. And if you provide it a 6, you would want 6 to be high and the rest to be low. And so there is a network that's been created for this, and I'm using this as an example. It's a network by Nielsen, and it has only one hidden layer. So you have your input layer right here, and this input layer has 748 neurons, and that's because there are 748 pixels in the input image. It's a 28 by 28 image. Remember, these are just the values of the pixels, not really neurons doing the entire computation using the activation function. These are just passed through as the output, each one of these inputs. And so you have 784 inputs, and then you have a hidden layer with 30 neurons, and these are fully connected to the inputs. And then you have an output layer, as we said before, with 10 neurons, one for each one of the 10 digits, 0 through 9. And so in this case, if you feed it a 6, you would like to get a high value activation value for 6 right here, and ideally 1 for 6 and 0 for everything else. So this network has been proven to perform with an accuracy of about 95%, which is very impressive, very respectable, given how challenging the problem is and the variability in terms of different handwritings. Okay, so now let's say that we don't have a trained network and we simply randomize the weights and biases. What does that mean? We randomly assign the values of the weights and biases of the entire network. Well, you sort of know what you can expect in this case. It's not going to be a reliable output. Now, if you show it this image right here, which is clearly a 6, because it's a random network, you're going to get unpredictable values here. In this particular case, you get a high value for 4, which is not what you're looking for. And the question is, if you start with this sort of a network, which is random assignment of weights, and random because you don't know where else to start, then the question is, how do we change the weights and biases in such a way that our activations or outputs end up approaching the desired activations? And that's the process of training, and that's what we're going to talk about next. So in order to do this, we need some training data. This is key to any network. You need lots of training data, more the better. So the training data in this case is essentially pairs of inputs and outputs. So you have these digits right here. These are what we call training images referred to by X. And we have roughly 60,000 such training images in the case of the MNIST data set. And so for each training image, we know what the label is that has been decided by users in the past or experts as that this is indeed a 5. There's an agreement between them that that's a 5. So we'll take that as the label. And each one of these labels can be converted into a desired activation, which is the output of the network that we would like to see. So for every image, we have the desired activation, A hat X. That's what's given to us. So now let's take a look at how training works. I'm just going to outline the training process for you, and then we'll go into the details later. So here's your training data, your 60,000 odd images. Here's your neural network. And the first thing we're going to do is what we mentioned before, just assign random values to the weights and biases of the network. That's the initialization process. So basically you have a network, not a very useful one, but you have a network. And now what we're going to do is compute the network activations, that's the outputs, for each one of the training images. We know how to do that. That's just a feed-forward process. We take each one of our images and run it through the network, and we get an activation on the output. So there's your 5, and then we can go to the 0, and so on. So by doing that, you're going to get an activation for each one of your training images. Not the desired activation, but we see the activation that this particular instantiation of the network is going to give you. And using all of these activation, you're going to compute the cost for the entire training data. The weaker the performance of the network, the larger the cost. So let's take a look at how we compute the cost. So here is, for any given image X, here is your desired activation, right here. You get zeros for everything except the digit that it actually represents. And let's say a random network provides you this activation right here. You take the Euclidean difference between the two, the Euclidean distance between the two, and you square it up. That's going to be the cost for the image X. So once again, that's written here. That's A hat, which is your desired activation for X, minus the activation that you get right now, the activation for X given the current parameters W and B of the network. And so the difference between the two squared. And you're going to take all of these costs for your images. In our case, we have 60,000 images, and we're going to find the average of that cost. The reason we find the average is we don't want the cost to be a function of the number of images in the training data. And so this cost is what we're trying to minimize. If you think about our problem, we are trying to find the W's and B's that's going to give us the minimum cost. So we lower the cost, better the classification, better the performance of the network. So that's how we compute the cost for the entire training data. Now we have the cost, and using this cost, we want to then adjust the weights and biases of the network. We want to tweak them all, move them in the right direction so that we're heading towards a lower cost. And the method we use for doing that is called gradient descent, a very well-known method for optimization. It's iterative optimization, and it can be used to find the local minimum of any differentiable function. So we're going to talk about gradient descent in greater detail. So what we do then is to adjust the weights and biases and then repeat this process. So repeat steps 2 to 3, 2 to 4 until the cost goes below some acceptable level, and then you freeze the network.